All right. So we've basically gotten, we've covered thus far sort of the first part of your story, your initial enlistment in the Air Force, and have gotten you back from Vietnam into civilian life for a while. And now, what year is it that you go back into the Air Force?
72.
Okay. All right. And then describe now your first assignment once you come back.
First assignment is at Langley Air Force Base. It was the headquarters to Tactical Air Command.
Mm-hmm.
There I worked in the emergency room because of my experience in Vietnam.
Mm-hmm.
It was just endless teaching a lot of young people how to do the job, mm-hmm. also what we call buddy care, teaching some of these other units this buddy care, and also I was in charge of CPR. And we would hold classes for civilians, for officers' wives, for whatever, whomever.
All right. And were you living off the base because you were married? Or?
Yes, we were off the base. We lived in Newport News, Virginia.
Mm-hmm.
And we had, by that time, added a little girl, mm-hmm. Julie. And the three of us were living off base in a two-story townhouse with a rent of $155 a month, and it was brand new. That would even cover the electric bill now.
Okay. All right. So how long did you stay there?
We stayed there until July of 1977.
Okay. Now, it's kind of a turbulent period that you're there. You're not far from Washington, D.C. and things like that either necessarily, because you had the end of the Vietnam War and Watergate and all of that kind of stuff. The military at times also, it was also downsizing and varying degrees. Now, how much of those external events or changes in the military had any effect on what you saw in the Air Force?
Well, you saw a lot of officers reduced in force, mm-hmm. and therefore became enlisted or got out.
Yeah.
We worked a lot. We had a big influence. It was with the wives of POWs,
mm-hmm.
because being a headquarters TAC base, General Mohmeyer was a four-star general there, and I think there were like 11 generals on base mm-hmm. altogether. They had just brought in the F-15, because that was just after Vietnam. So that had a lot to do with it. Downtown, you didn't see, because it's such a military area. Norfolk, Virginia, mm-hmm. Portsmouth, Virginia, Fort Eustis up in Newport News, Langley Air Force Base. So you didn't see that much there. The biggest influence that I saw when I was there was during the Israeli Six-Day War.
Mm-hmm.
Because they came to work and all of a sudden there were machine gun nests at the front gate. Wait a minute, what's going on? These weren't war games.
Mm-hmm.
Because needless to say, the hospital gets involved in all war games. And just as we were waiting to get in, they were checking ideas. I looked up and there was a big jet aircraft coming in, and it was LL. But the logo on the vertical stabilizer had been painted up. You could see where the paint ran, because Langley was the closest base for Israel at the time for resupply,
mm-hmm.
and there were guys and they were going 24/7. All sorts of aircraft going in, mm-hmm. contract aircraft, LL, the whole bit, to supply them, because it was pretty serious for the first 5 days, as you all know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay. You also mentioned sort of the wives of POWs. I mean, the POWs from Vietnam come back in 73.
Right.
All right. And did they process through Langley if they were Air Force, or were there just a lot of the families living in that area?
Yeah, there are a lot of families living in the support groups.
Mm-hmm.
They pretty much wanted to disperse. They didn't make a big deal of it, in a sense. I mean, you had Operation Homecoming, you had the C-141 on TV and so, but most of those guys just wanted to get on with their lives, and there was some really, I got more involved with the POWs when we were in Germany.
Mm-hmm.
And at Laughlin Air Force Base, because these colonels then had been there. And being a senior NCO, you had inner workings. And mm-hmm. if you'd been to Vietnam, then there would be a conversation going on between a couple of them and myself and maybe another NCO, and you'd walk up and the conversation would immediately stop,
because mm-hmm.
you hadn't been there.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just all right. It was. It hadn't been to NAM, so therefore it's a brotherhood that it'd be nice if nobody belonged to.
Mm-hmm.
But it's a special group.
Right. Okay. And so you got that assignment then at Langley. And then is it routine to kind of change and go other places, or how does that work?
Yeah, the Air Force is pretty stable, mm-hmm. and versus the Navy, the Army, the Marine Corps. They're more family-oriented. They're combat-oriented, yes, but not in a... When you think of the Marines, you think of the sergeant. You think of the Navy, you think of the old chief. You think of the Army, you think of the sergeant. You think of the Air Force, you think of a pilot.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? It's a different level. The housing and so was always good. We stayed there 5.5 years.
Mm-hmm. All right. And when you left, was that your idea or the Air Force?
No, it was time to rotate.
Okay.
We went to Izmir, Turkey.
Mm-hmm.
And the whole family went. That was a two-year tour because there was no base there.
Mm-hmm.
We did like embassy duty. We lived downtown Izmir. It was like everybody else did. Okay, there was an air base about 10 kilometers away. It was called Chile Air Base.
Mm-hmm.
It's a Turkish base. The air vac would come in twice a week, which we would have to go meet and put people on. If a woman was pregnant at 8 months, she had to go to Germany. Because
mm-hmm.
if she had a boy, then he would be subject to the draft if he ever came back to Turkey.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. But the unique thing was when those aircraft landed, none of them said United States Air Force. They said the United States of America and had a flag. There was no military on those.
Mm-hmm.
Because that particular base, Chile, had Jupiter missiles. And that was the base Kennedy gave the missiles away from for Khrushchev to get rid of the missiles in Cuba.
Right.
So it was really, we went in there with ambulances, and the cross, like I told them, most people didn't know what the Red Cross meant because it's an Islamic country,
mm-hmm.
and you're looking at a crescent,
yeah.
because a cross would be proselytizing Christianity.
Right. Okay.
So
basically, so you worked at a hospital in Izmir, was that that, or?
Well, it was called a clinic.
Okay.
Okay, but sometimes we would keep people overnight until we could get them out the next day. Just basically a clinic, a shot clinic, a vet's. Because they had that commissary in there, and it was all pretty well disguised.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, it wasn't buried out. We were in an old Turkish building, and we only lived like 4 blocks away. We lived right in downtown Israel, which is just, if it wasn't for the regime now, I'd go back to Turkey in a moment's notice. I loved it. No TV, no television, no phone for 2 years. Didn't miss it a bit.
Okay. So I guess if there wasn't really a big American military facility there.
No.
Why
NATO.
Okay.
The ships would come in, there'd be an American, a Turkish, an Italian, and an English.
Mm-hmm. So you're basically servicing people going through either the ships or through the aircraft? Or
No.
Or do you just have personnel who
the
were there?
The personnel that were there. We had worked there. You had the 16th Air Force was there. A lot of it, I don't know about. All I know, a good friend of mine was a Navy captain, and he represented a 3-star admiral.
Mm-hmm.
And there was so much of don't ask, don't tell.
Okay.
So I don't know, and what they told me was fine. And that's, I was an E-5 at the time. There'd be myself and a 2-striper, and we'd run the clinic from 7 in the evening till 7 at night.
Mm-hmm.
No,
7 in the morning?
7 in the morning, excuse me. Yeah. And the doors were, and what was really, it was a very safe place. It's probably one of the safest mm-hmm. places Carol's ever been with children. But during May Day, the last 2 days in April and May Day, they weren't allowed out of their apartments. So there were big apartment parties mm-hmm. going on. And we're supposed to blend in a civilian culture. I'm going to really blend in mm-hmm. like in front of the Mideast, right?
Yeah.
And there'd be a tank in front of the clinic, and there'd be a machine gun nest up on top of the clinic because of the big communist rallies mm-hmm. at that time.
Yeah, because May Day is Communist Party Day.
You got it.
So you right. have that there. So what were your kids old enough to be in school?
Julie was. She was in the first grade. And this captain, naval captain, his wife was a first grade teacher.
Mm-hmm. So there was an American school there?
No.
How did the school
work? They called it the Department of Defense School System.
Okay.
Okay. And it was in an old tobacco warehouse. Because there weren't that many students there.
Mm-hmm.
They had an old gym. This is as long as halftime, then everybody realized it was on a different cycle, so the clock was moving mm-hmm. much slower. But things like that. There was a church there that they would use. We went to a Catholic service that was in an old building hidden.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Again, you could practice Christianity, but you couldn't proselytize Christianity.
Right.
Christmas trees were in the back of the house, no decorations on the windows.
Yeah.
Really, and you need, it makes going to church a lot more fun when you know you're not supposed to do it.
Gotcha.
But the beggars would be out there every Sunday. They knew where those Christians were. Okay. It was a great place to live. It really was. Right.
But on the whole, basically, the local population was
very friendly.
Very friendly and positive. Yeah.
In our apartment building, we were on this floor. The next floor was a constitutional lawyer. He had three daughters. And then sometimes the mayor of Izmir would come over.
Mm-hmm.
And when he came over, there were gendarmes in the hallways, mm-hmm. okay? And they would come down to ask my two daughters to somebody say goodnight to grandma and grandpa up there. Both my daughters were blue-eyed blondes.
Mm-hmm.
And if somebody's big, like the mayor was there or something, they wanted him to come. They'd show them off, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's really interesting when you watch your two daughters walking down the hallway with armed guards in front and back with automatic weapons. It's a unique experience.
Right.
And they would never charge us money because they thought it was an honor to watch those children. Mm-hmm. And you could trust them, that's max.
All right. Was that a 2-year stint?
Yeah, 2-year.
Okay. All right. And what comes after that?
Laughlin Air Force Base, Del Rio, Texas, 150 miles due west of San Antonio.
All right.
On the Rio Grande.
Okay. And what was your job there?
Ran an emergency room, and then I went and ran the OB department, and then I went and got promoted and ended up being the senior NCO and the superintendent of all the enlisted in the hospital.
Okay.
Del Rio, out in the middle of nowhere, small town, it was a UPT base, undergraduate pilot training, because it had like 350 days a year of flying.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I did some flying down there, private pilot, and Carol Ann was the evening supervisor at the local hospital,
mm-hmm.
and the girls were both in private schools because the public schools were so inundated, and so many of these young children didn't speak English, mm-hmm. and crying, we just had to put them in private schools.
Yeah, you face that kind of choice, okay, what's best for my kid at that
point. Not being racist, it's just I've got children that are going to be moving on, and they need, you know, if I have a moral obligation to make sure that they have
mm-hmm.
a good education. And they've both been through and graduated from college now, so I didn't do too bad. Except for the old man.
Mm-hmm. All right. And so how long did you stay there?
Almost 5.5 years.
Okay. As you're going on through this sort of Air Force career, are you seeing any kind of changes in the culture or the way that people think?
Extreme. You see, so much of this, it got to the point where I'm not an airman anymore. I'm an air person.
Mm-hmm.
It got almost ridiculous. It really did. In the 70s, everybody from the rank of colonel and below, full bird colonel and below, had to go to race relations in 72 and 73.
Mm-hmm.
What did you get out of this program? Well, first of all, why don't you talk about the real people that were discriminated upon, the Native Americans? Okay? Now, that wasn't a popular thing for me to say. And I had just been through all this social stuff at the University of Texas. Mm-hmm. These people didn't know what a hippie was. They didn't know.
Mm-hmm.
I saw Janis Joplin. She was from here to him performing. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, Hendrix and all those people. They had no idea of some stuff going on. But like in the Air Force, and they said, well, what did you learn most from the Air Force? Race relation programs. And I guess maybe you can call this ignorance, I don't know. But the most I learned from it was that a bunch of new names you call me and a bunch of new names I can call you. You know, because you never hear this. I mean, to me, I can't sit here and tell you, you know, you can talk to me all day, but you're not going to change my mind if I can't have a reasonable argument.
Mm-hmm.
And this was really, it was so bad, it was unreal.
And you'd been in plenty of situations where people of different races had just worked together anyway.
Yeah, that's the whole point. You know, I've worked with everybody, I'm sure, from every race, color, creed, ethnic origin, developed, lived in the cultures in Turkey, Germany, Vietnam, you know. It got me on the city council at Roosevelt Park, and it's probably one of the things that got me voted. I don't work with anybody.
Mm-hmm.
You know, everybody's got the right to express their own idea and their own opinion. I know they may not agree, but that doesn't count.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. But they were trying to modernize that. Now, were women doing more and more things over
Definitely.
The course of the time you were in?
The last 5 years, especially, when I was in Germany, being in a mobile tactical radar unit. And it got to the point, especially with the security police, the medics and the cops always work together. Mm-hmm. Okay? I don't know how that started, but it does. Hey, I don't care if she's only 100 pounds. She's got the job. Equal rights, equal work. If you get hung, get out. Well, we're just supposed to take care of her. Well, then that means I've got to let my guard down because I got to watch her plus me, so that puts me at danger. I don't want her with me. Well, that's discrimination. No, that's light. And there was so much about that. You know, she's only 100 pounds. And most of the times the girls would, the females, pulled her own, but you always had a few that, you know, but you got to send it with guys too. Mm-hmm. So, but the guy didn't smack him around.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And yeah, there was a lot of that, big time.
They're still kind of just sorting out how to make it work and what work and what doesn't, and a new set of variables to throw into the ones you already had.
Exactly. Okay. Exactly. It's like right now, we were talking to a recruiter because I was looking up flag etiquette and basic training. You don't even make your own beds anymore. You've got somebody coming to make your beds.
Wow.
You've got to be kidding. 6-inch white collar, bounce that quarter, perfectly 45 degree, you know. Well, we're more technical now. Well, of course, in the Air Force now, they want a year of college before you can even be enlisted.
Mm-hmm.
Things change.
Yeah. All right. And so what were the dates of that stay at Del Rio?
Okay, July of 79 until 84, February of 85.
Okay. And then do you go to Germany from there?
Right.
Okay. So talk about that assignment.
Okay. Well, when I went, we got the assignment. I also had to go to what we call independent duty school, site medic, whatever you want to call it. And the thing was, we spent nine weeks at Shepherd Air Force Base, nine senior NCOs. Most of us outranked instructor, which is no big deal. But I'm like, I've done this, son. Now you're going to send me to 9 weeks of school to teach me what I already know.
Mm-hmm.
So he says, well, this is the heart. There are two things that empty into the heart, the inferior vena cava and the superior vena cava. Well, you're wrong. You forgot the coronary solus, which comes into the right auricle. It comes out of the left one because it's got the richest blood, and that's the thing that fills the coronary system, which fills up the heart. Well, you don't need to know that much. We all threw stuff at him. And then, I'm sorry, yeah. You want to talk about battle signs? Okay, they send us to this so-called field training, right? And we're with nurses now, this big class, like Carol said, hers. But how do you take four people over the top of this wall, you know, with the litter and so on, the patient? I stood there and said, you ready to go? And I looked at the major, I said, you know, this is one of the dumbest things I've ever seen. I said, they taught us the same crap in 1963 at Greenville Air Force Base. Well, Sergeant, you're supposed to duck lower so you don't make a profile. I said, listen, stupid. Excuse my French. You never go over anything, because then you break profile, and I'm going to put a 223 right between your eyes, or if I feel good, I just put it through your neck and paralyze you. And these kids looking at you, go around it, you go through it, or you go under it, but you never go over it. And the guys that did, you can go visit them in their graves. This major walked out, she said, this class is over with. I said, thank you, ma'am. She came back. She said, would you do some writing for us here to correct this? I'd be happy to. Then we all got drunk with her and everybody. And another story. But yeah, so we went to independent duty school. Drawing blood, filling a couple of teeth, setting a bone, taking care of burns, stuff we've done. Okay, and then we had to go to the hospital and pull sick call with a doctor. And then we tell him everything. And he'd sit there with his coat and say, yep, this is the best job I ever had. Senior, you got it all. And then after that, we went to Simbach, West Germany.
Okay.
Small little base. It was a French base during World War II. It's outside of Kaiserslautern, which is a big military presence. Mm-hmm. And there's, my God, army all over the place.
Mm-hmm.
And there I was, I went to a mobile tactical radar unit. Everything's on trucks. We go out to the field, we dig holes, we set up concertina wire, we set up the scopes, they see the bad aircraft coming in, they vector in the good guys, and hopefully they all turn before anybody crosses a line. Because the wall and everything was still there. My job, of course, was everything. To do medically, food, records, you name it. I loved it. Loved it. No officers over me, no. The commander, you walk in the staff briefing, doctor, check out for me today. That's that. We're going to do this. Do it. is you're in complete control.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So it really worked out in great rapport with all the people in the unit. And it was a 603rd tech control flight. Then they disbanded that because of the satellites.
Mm-hmm.
So they made me the inspector of all the IDMTs, the cruise missile guys, the site medics of Germany. So we did a lot of traveling, 2 or 3 days at a time, and always be home for the weekends and so. And then when they had their big out in the field war games, I would go and do that and then sleep at a hotel at night and then evaluate these people during the day. A lot of times I'd stay with them in their tents because to me, it just rubbed me the wrong way that I'm nice and warm and dry and you guys mm-hmm. are in tents. You got pallets on for a floor and the water's running through the pallets. But you got the medical people, though, had no idea what this was all about.
Mm-hmm.
You put plastic bags over the top of your medicine cabinets. Well, good, you keep the dust out. No, man, that's so when the tactical nuke hits, it doesn't all get radiated, mm-hmm. but we can still use them. Oh, well, how do you clean the floors? We open up this end of the tent and that end of the tent, and Mother Nature just blows it like a madman. But you should do... No ideas.
So you had a lot of practical experience that you brought in.
Hands-on, yeah, mm-hmm. that's it. Some of these commanders would say, hey, we need a medic and we want Sergeant Sutton only.
Mm-hmm.
Because we do their guy's buddy. Plus the credibility. Been there, done that,
mm-hmm.
you know? Were you ever scared? If you're not, you're stupid.
All right. And what was the... And you had your family with you, right?
Yes.
Okay, so what kind of accommodations did you have there?
We had really a nice... We were in like a big apartment building. There were 12 families, 15 families
mm-hmm.
on three floors, all senior NCOs, a couple of Army, a lot of the Air Force, three-bedroom apartment, cable. This is what you watch, because this is the only station you got.
Mm-hmm.
God, we hated NBC News. But anyhow, because Brian Gummel had come over, and he was such a jackass, it was unbelievable. But... very nice accommodations. Jennifer went to school on base. Mm-hmm. Julie went to Kaiserslautern High School and had these big Mercedes buses that would take them to school and bring them back.
So was she taking classes in German then?
Carol was.
Okay, but Julie, was she? Or was there an American section there or something?
Well, it was American High School.
Okay.
Kaiserslautern High School.
All right.
And then Carol, she worked at Ramstein High School. She became a school nurse. And that was the best time we ever had, because that lady, she does the best nursing job she ever had.
Mm-hmm.
Weekends, holidays off, big vacation in the summertime, so many sick days. I mean, it was great for her, you know, there and back. And we had to buy we bought a brand new Ford Aerostar van for traveling, because we did a lot of running around in Europe. But I also had a Porsche. And we bought the Aerostar van because Mama was driving to work at 110 miles an hour. I know, she's got a lead foot. So, yeah, and we did. We would go on Saturday, we'd go to France, the Alsace region, grocery shopping,
mm-hmm.
lunch at Luxembourg, Black Horse, get a cuckoo clock or something, maybe in Switzerland, and then and home.
Yeah. All right. Now, you're also there, because you were there, what, till 89, 90?
90.
Okay. You're also there at the point when the kind of the Cold War is starting to kind of come to an end.
Right.
And things are the Berlin Wall comes.
Right.
Okay. So how much of that did you observe or was going on while you were there?
Okay. We knew what was going on because of the good newspaper, also German newspaper mm-hmm. and the news. So we got the NBC News.
Mm-hmm.
We went down. Everybody went to red when the wall was coming down. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you know the topography of Germany. But this is Germany. You got mountains to the north, mountains to the south. But in the center, perfect tank country
mm-hmm.
to go to Bremerhaven, those places. So they didn't know. It was just something that the black was going to pull off.
Mm-hmm.
And going down with Mikhail Gorbachev, with Reagan, and all that stuff. So we were, I can't remember the name. I don't even know if it had a name. A bunch of army guys as backups. As backup medics, and there was an area where nobody walks. And you got the East Germans or the whomever they are,
mm-hmm.
and you got the Americans. And all of a sudden they turned around and left. What the hell's going on? And they brought in a couple of gunships, And they were just sort of hovering there, you know? And then they left. So we all sat down and had a beer. That was it. Came back home and then we saw the wall went down. We got a piece of it at home.
Right. And then were there people coming in from East Germany at that point?
Oh my God, unbelievable. There's so many bad traffic accidents because they would come in to West Germany. The West Germans didn't want them, by the way. Mm-hmm. Okay. They would come in and these cars would be so overloaded that their headlights would be almost pointing up. And they'd be in the left lane. And some guy comes in with his Mercedes or Audi at 140 mm-hmm. miles an hour. And there's baggage and people left all over. On the Autobahn, you have flatbeds and helicopters. Mm-hmm. And that's it. Because, I mean, I came home from Europe. I came home from Frankfurt, which is a four lane both ways. Mm-hmm. And you have got four lanes of traffic. You got the slow lane at 60 miles an hour, 100 kilometers. You got the fast lane, you got the super fast lane, and then you got the, you better get out of the way lane.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and of course in Europe, you know, turn on your tape. You're in front of me, you hit your right turn signal. I have to let you in. When I come up behind you and I want to pass, I turn on my left turn signal, you turn on your right turn signal, you get over and I go on through.
Mm-hmm.
I was drafting a Porsche at close to 125, a little over 200 kilometers an hour. Looked in the rearview mirror and I saw a flashing orange light. I said, you've got to be putting me on, dude. So I was drafting this Porsche in front of me, so I hit the lights and we both pulled over. And about that time, this little black thing went by me. He had to be doing 160, 170. Lamborghini Countach. Couldn't even get the plate. And then I heard this roar, and I went, oh, that's a Ferrari. Three red Ferraris are chasing this guy, trying to catch him.
Mm-hmm.
This is just driving home on Friday night from Frankfurt.
All right. Now, of course, the East Germans had cars. I mean, some of them were these little plastic things with motorcycle engines in them.
Yeah. And they'd be full of people, and the baggage would all be up on top, and they couldn't maintain the speed.
Yeah.
And they didn't know how to drive anymore, you know? And they'd be in the wrong lane, and they'd come over the hill and hit them. And it was, and of course, they gave them each $100 a piece. I never forget what the fact. Mm-hmm. The West Germans were just madder than snot about that. Nobody was happy about the East Germans coming across. Nobody wanted them. They're stupid, they're dumb, they're lazy. Well, yeah, they've been in communism. They've been given everything, mm-hmm. you know? You owe me? Oh, yeah, they didn't have no use for them.
Right. Now, was that kind of stuff still going on by the time you left, or?
Yeah.
The official union of the two countries is still not for another year or something.
Yeah, because the wall went down in 89.
Mm-hmm.
And we left in July of 90.
Yeah. All right. Now, at this point, have you gotten sort of to retirement age or?
Right, I had 24 and a half years in.
Mm-hmm.
Where do you want to go? Well, let's see where they send us first.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we got orders to go to Miami. Two daughters, Miami. Drug culture. I had been down there one weekend. And Julie had just started at First State, okay? Mm-hmm. Mama's gotta be with her babies. You have to realize I have a daughter, I have two daughters, a wife, and I always come in fifth.
Mm-hmm.
And I haven't figured that out yet. But anyhow, no, and then of course what happened, the name of the base was Homestead. In the following year, the big hurricane
right.
blew everything off. It was probably the best decision I've made in my life. Because at that time, it's like I told the fellow, I said, you know, yeah, people would scream to go to Miami. This is a family decision.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And everybody's got an equal vote.
Mm-hmm.
And Mama wants to be by her babies. Jennifer wants to go back to America. She's never lived in a house.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Julie's at Ferris State. Kind of civil decision.
All right. So now when you get out, now your wife continues to work as a nurse, right?
Right.
Right. So she still has a job. Do you go get another job, or what do you do?
Yeah, because there's no way you can just sit around. The retirement's a, I don't know who brought that term up, but I'm sorry. I'm type A personality. Okay. Yeah, we did, and I always liked to cook, so I got a job in a fine dining restaurant. The chef and got trained.
Mm-hmm.
And I've worked at a couple other restaurants, ran a couple other kitchens, and like I told my wife, I started at the top, and I've been working my way down ever since. At Double J Ranch up here, ran a few kitchens for her, and so we did that. And then I, in 1995, we left that I went to work in a factory, which I swore I'd never do.
Mm-hmm.
But it was a great place to work. I was there for 13 years. And then they bought me out.
Mm-hmm.
And that's fine. And I'm pretty sure I'm going to go back to work again.
Okay.
Been doing stuff around the house. I've been taking up abstract painting. I've been going to MCC with a 4-point average. Where was I? 50 years ago. Oh, my God. Dummy. I've been going to Kendall Art School. Night classes there, mm-hmm. not regular. I got $14,000 for tuition, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But a lot of, and yeah, we've been doing a lot of that. We play golf and stuff like that.
Okay.
So it's been.
All right. So, you to look back on the whole thing, I mean, and of course, you had a career there. But how do you think your time in the service affected you, or what did you take out of it?
Probably many things. First of all, the ability to get along with anybody. When I come working here at the Silversides Museum, you got Navy, you got Coast Guard, and of course we rag each other all the time, but you're in that brotherhood. You know, mm-hmm. you weren't in, you got no business talking to us. But I'll call him a squid, he'll call me an Airedale, I'll call him a grunt, you know, all sorts of things like that. Probably the biggest thing that has opened me up to knowing, hey, I'm an American, you know, people don't realize not everybody loves us. We're not the sweetheart of the world by any means. Number two, we don't have the only way to do it. Well, why don't they do this over here? Well, because this country, I mean, I've eaten in restaurants whose foundations, excuse me, were laid before America was discovered.
Mm-hmm.
You know, why don't the Turks, the dirty Turks, I wouldn't eat that. They don't do their food like ours. Go to a Turkish restaurant, you see a bunch of dead bodies? No, it's probably pretty good, and they're great cooks. You know, so is it, I can get along with anybody, seriously, and that is, it's cultural. And I go to, it just amazes me, I just, took two semesters of American history, a semester of World War II, and people have no knowledge of America. Oh my God, it just blows me. And I took this art course from Tim Norris, from Renaissance to modern art. And I'm thinking, you know what? The smarter I get, the dumber I am. You know, wow, how all this stuff works in. And it, we used to go to the churches in Germany, look at the facades and so on.
Mm-hmm.
And it has really, I mean, everybody's got something. They really do. It's just, to me, it's obviously made me a better person, obviously made me an easier person to live with. Basically, that's how I got elected to the city council. You know, because there's so much discourse up there that, you know, hey, I'm a team player, but I'm not a yes man. And that's the way it goes. And with the girls, still, I've got 27 to 26, a 19, and a 6-year-old grandchildren.
Mm-hmm.
I'm having a blast with that 6-year-old. Mama says no, daddy says no, grandpa says, how many would you like?
Yes. Well, you earn that privilege, I think.
Yeah. But it is, I think we should be like the Israelis. Everybody should go to the military for 2 years
mm-hmm.
to learn discipline, to learn your own self-respect, to learn to respect other people. And that the world, you know, it doesn't revolve around your video game.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, some of my students could probably learn that.
My gosh, hey, Mr. Sutton, please, Michael, I'm a student, just like you are, just because I'm older, and I understand that, but you went. Well, the instructor wrote on here comments on my test, and I can't read cursive.
Wow, yeah?
You've got to be, but our 6-year-old is learning how to write cursive. She goes to Grand Rapids Christian. So they're teaching us. I say, you got to be. Chris is a second language to them. Because
mm-hmm.
I thought you were pulling me out. So I said, well, you've got to work a little bit harder, and I don't believe this whole paper. Well, I got to be on it. You really can't read this, can you? No. I said, okay, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to insult you. That's how I found out.
Yep.
You know? And like the history instructor was saying, we were sitting in class in the second semester of American history, we were into the Vietnam area, and we just kept everything quiet. Okay, I didn't answer questions unless they couldn't. Yeah. What you're studying about the civil rights in your textbook, I read in the newspaper.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and it would turn out being, where do you go for about the Vietnam War? Well, I go to this book. What's the best source? Well, somebody that's been there. He said, turn around.
Mm-hmm.
What did I do? You know, because I was a listener. And yeah, it was really, really interesting.
All right. Well, the whole thing makes for a pretty darn good story. So I'd like to thank you for taking the time to share today.
No problem. some things aren't repeatable, and other things aren't necessary to repeat. You know what I mean? Basically, you think, I do. You think of the funny and the happy things, like trying to shoot a fly with an M16. Yep. Okay, other things that happen. Fortunately, the bad is, I've got like 750 slides, and they're all things you could show your grandmother.